Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to give you an overview of the main results about the Voller model, a little bit like I did for the contact process, by giving you some kind of summary of the main papers about the model that were written starting from its introduction in the 70s. So, the first important result about the model is exactly what we proved in the previous video, that shows that you have a phase transition going from a dimension less or equal to 2 to dimension strictly larger than 2, and so a phase transition between a phase of clustering and a phase of coexistence. And so again, you remember that the proof was based on looking at the duality relationship between the Voller model and its dual, which consists of a system of coalescing symmetric random walk. And we saw that the difference in behavior is in fact due to the fact that random walks are recurrent in one and two dimension, but transient in higher dimension. So this result was first proved in this paper by Holly and Liggett, published in 1975. And more precisely, their result says the following. So that's a little bit more precise than what we proved in the previous video. It says that if we start from the product measure with density rho, meaning again that initially each individual is of type 1 with probability rho and of type 0 with probability 1 minus rho independently of each other, then in one and two dimension, we have what we can call consensus also, if you think of the Voller model as an opinion model instead of competition between two different types of individuals. And so in one and two dimension, you have consensus, meaning that you have, in fact, convergence in distribution to this convex combination with weight 1 minus rho and rho of those two Dirac measures, delta 0, delta 1. Here I'm using 0 and 1 for the all 0 configuration and all 1 configuration. And at the opposite, if you go in higher dimension, you have coexistence in the sense that we have convergence to a stationary and invariant measure that I call here xi infinity. And under this invariant measure, the density of type 1 individual is going to be equal to rho. So that's more or less what we proved, except that, again, in like the theorem I just showed you is a little bit more specific because it shows how this parameter rho comes into play in the limiting behavior of the process. So it's in fact very easy to prove that the density of type 1 individual or also the density of type 2 of type 0 individuals are quantities that are preserved by the dynamics of the Voller model. That's just based on the fact that each time two different individuals interact, there is equal chance that a 1 becomes a 0 or a 0 becomes a 1. And so because of that, the density of type 1 type 0 is preserved. And so from this, we can kind of deduce that in the case of one and two dimension, we are going to have, again, clustering. In the theorem, we say convergence to a convex combination of two Dirac measures. The way you have to interpret the theorem is really thinking that if you look at a big box, but a finite box, finite but big box, eventually, if you wait long enough, that's what we proved in the previous video, if you wait long enough, all the individuals in this box will be of the same type, with probability close to 1, as when time is large. And this theorem gives you one more specification, which is the fact that if indeed all the individuals in this box are of the same type, they will all be of type 1 with probability rho and all be of type 0 with probability 1 minus rho. Same idea for the second part of the theorem, where you have coexistence. Now, instead of having those clusters that keep growing, and so you don't really have a stable equilibrium, except for the two absorbing states. Now, in this case, you have indeed some invariant measure with a positive density of each type. And Now at the opposite, if you look at a big box, it seems that in average, you will see a fraction rho of type 1 and a fraction 1 minus rho of type 0. So that was the first result proved about the Wöhler model. So now, let's look more carefully at the clustering phase. So in this case, we know that we have those clusters that keep growing. And a natural question is, how fast do they grow? Okay, the result we prove, it just tells us that they keep growing forever, so they are bigger and bigger and bigger, but the result we prove doesn't say anything about how big they are. And so the second natural question is about the cluster size. So of course, cluster size only in the case where we have clustering, so cluster size in the case of dimension less or equal to 2. What can we say about that? So, looking at a picture that I showed you already before, you see that, again, you have a realization of the one-dimensional Wöhler model on the left, a snapshot of the two-dimensional Wöhler model on the right, and already a first challenge that we have is, what do we mean by cluster size? This quantity is not clearly defined. It's clear how we can define it, in fact, in one dimension, but not really in two dimensions. So in one dimension, to understand what we mean by cluster size, you can just draw an horizontal line like that. So across space, you draw a line across space. And and then clearly along this line, you will see a succession of intervals of type 0 and intervals of type 1. Those intervals, of course, because the process is stochastic, do not have exactly the same length, but because the process is translation invariant, like at least in distribution, this means that the length of those intervals are identically distributed. And the question is, well, what can we say about the distribution of the length? Now, if at the opposite you look at the picture on the right, it's not clear what we mean by cluster size, and this mostly because, well, you see those clusters, they are not like perfect circles with a very specific radius or perfect rectangles, for instance. They are all scattered everywhere, and so it's not really clear how to define what we mean by cluster size. And so to measure the size of the clusters, what we are going to do instead is kind of try to measure the spatial correlations between sites, but those sites are not fixed. They are far from each other and they move far away from each other as time evolves. So more precisely, to understand the cluster size, we do the following. The idea is to do the following. You look at the process at time t, you think of t as something that will go to infinity, and then you take two sites, let's call them x and y, but then we know that if x and y are fixed and t goes to infinity, eventually in one and two dimensions, those two sites will be identical. So instead, we are going to assume that in fact those sites kind of depend on time, okay? And we are going to assume that the distance, in fact, between them is a function of time. And clearly, if this function of time increases too fast, then that means those two vertices are going to be far from each other, then those two sides should be independent. At the opposite, if this distance here does not increase very fast with time, then those two sides should be fully strongly correlated, like meaning have the same value. And so the way you look at whether those two sides are correlated or not is by looking at the probability that the random walk in the dual like process coalesce or not before reaching time zero. Okay? So the idea to really measure the cluster size is to look at two sites at distance, let's say t at the power alpha from each other. And then the idea is that if alpha is too big, and so the distance here is too big, those two undermorphs won't have time to coalesce. At the opposite, if alpha is small, then the distance between those two vertices is not very big as a function of t, and so that in this case the two undermorphs will have time to coalesce. And so the question about solving the cluster size is really about looking at two undermorphs starting in one or two dimensions. We know that eventually those undermorphs are going to meet each other, and the question is how long does it take for them to meet, depending on the distance between them. So, for instance, you see in this picture that if indeed we probably close to one, two sites at distance t at the power alpha apart have time to coalesce, like their ancestors have time to coalesce in t units of time, this would mean that the clusters have size at least t at the power alpha. At the opposite, if the two undermorphs don't have time to coalesce, there is a high probability that they don't have time to coalesce, that will mean that the cluster size scales like something smaller than t at the power alpha. So, more precisely, to really understand this idea of cluster size, and you see that the construction I give you, like even if I draw a picture in one dimension, now you can also answer this question in two dimensions, and that's really the way you are going to measure those clusters in two dimensions. So now the question is to understand the cluster size is really to look at the limit when t goes to infinity of the probability that xi t of not x but xt, okay, is different from xi t of yt. So that's exactly, so we prove that if x, xt and yt are fixed, do not depend on time, then this in one and two dimension goes to zero. Now the question is, for which value of alpha this goes to zero or something positive? So the size of the cluster for the Wöhler model in one dimension was studied in this paper by Bronson and Griffiths. And following the strategy I just showed you, they were able to prove this theorem, which says that, again, if we assume that we have two sites that are at distance t at the power alpha apart, then the probability that at time t those two sites are going to be of different type is going to converge to 2 rho times 1 minus rho if alpha is strictly larger than 1 half, and 0 if alpha is strictly less than 1 half. So I call the first case the case of independence, and the second case the case of total correlations. So what does it mean? So what they prove basically is that the cutoff here is alpha equals 1 half. And so what they showed is that if alpha is strictly less than 1 half, then that means that this length is of an order of magnitude much less, like it's much smaller, or it's small compared to square root of t. Then in this case, those two undermorphs have time to coalesce. Okay, and the probability that those two things are different is equal to 0. So this means, because we have this cutoff of 1 half, this means that the size of the clusters in one dimension is at least scales like at least square root of t. Okay? Now, the fact that 1 half is exactly the cutoff means that, in fact, both clusters scales exactly like the cluster size scales exactly like square root of t. So, their result, in fact, shows that that in one dimension, if you look at the Wöhler model at time t, what you will see is a bunch of a succession of intervals, and those intervals are of the order scales like square root of the time. So now one little observation about their limit when we assume that alpha is strictly larger than 1 half. So obviously when alpha is larger than 1 half, we don't know that this limit is equal to 1. What we know is that those two random walks don't have time to coalesce. And so that means that those two sites are going to be independently of type 1 or type 0 with probability 0 and 1 minus 4. That's why in their limit, they get that this limit here, when the two sites are independent, they don't have the same ancestor, is going to be equal to 2 rho times 1 minus rho. That's exactly the probability that we saw in the previous video. That's the probability that two sites in the initial configuration at time 0 are of different types. So that explains the behavior in one dimension. So in one dimension, we know that clusters at time t scales like square root of t. So that shows that those clusters, they indeed grow forever, but the growth is kind of slow. Now, the cluster size for the two-dimensional volar model was studied in this other paper. This one is by Cox and Griffiths. And what they proved is the following theorem at the bottom of the slide. So the assumptions are the same as in the previous theorem. We assume that we have two sites xt, yt at a distance about t at the power alpha apart, except that now we are in two dimensions. And they again looked at the probability that those two sites are of the same type or of different type when t goes to infinity. And you see that the first conclusion is the same as in the previous paper. When alpha is strictly larger than 1/2, then you have convergence to 2 rho times 1 minus rho, meaning that when alpha is strictly larger than 1/2, and so the distance between both sites is strictly larger, or like the order of magnitude is more than square root of t, then those sites are independent. That means that clusters in two dimension are not bigger like square root of t. But an interesting result also that they prove is that when alpha is strictly less than 1/2, you don't have any more convergence to zero. Now you have convergence to 4 rho times 1 minus rho times alpha. And notice that when alpha is exactly equal to 1/2, this quantity at the bottom is exactly equal to 2 rho times 1 minus rho, the same as in the case of independence. So the conclusion of their paper is that clusters are not bigger than square root of t in order of magnitude, but because there are only partial correlations when alpha is strictly less than 1/2, we cannot conclude anything about the cluster size in two dimensions. And so conclusion of those two papers, like those two theorems at the bottom of the slide, is that for the one-dimensional Wöhler model, the cluster size scales like square root of the time. But in the two-dimensional Wöhler model, there is no natural scale for the cluster size. Now let's look at another important aspect of the Wöhler model, this time for the Wöhler model in the coexistence phase, so in dimension 3 or higher. So obviously for this type of Wöhler model, the question of whether the question about the cluster size is not relevant anymore, because we don't have those clusters that keep growing. At the opposite, we reach some stable equilibrium. But there is still the question of whether those sites are strongly correlated or not. So indeed, even if we have coexistence, because the dynamics of the Wöhler model is described by those local interactions, we know that at equilibrium in higher dimension, sites are still not independent. And the question is to know how correlated they are. And so the question is, third question is about spatial correlations under the invariant measure at equilibrium in higher dimension. And so to study this aspect, what's natural is to do the following. We just look at, let's say, the process in a big box. So let's say that maybe here the length is n, and we are going to take the limit when n goes to infinity. And So basically, we know that the expected number of type 1 individuals in this box is equal to rho times the number of sites. So I'm drawing the picture in two dimensions, but we are in higher dimension, at least d equals 3. The number of sites in this box is about 2n at the power d. And we know that there is a fraction rho of those sites here in average that are of type 1. So now, assuming that the spatial correlations are weak under the invariant measure in higher dimension, this would mean that the deviation between the number of type 1 in a big box like that from its mean should be small. And so to kind of measure this fluctuation from the mean, how much does the number of type 1 in this box deviate from the mean, what we want to look at is some kind of central limit theorem. Okay, so we are going to look at number of type 1 in this box, that's a random variable. Correct this term by removing, subtracting the mean, and then we want to see how this thing behaves when we rescale by, typically, that should be the number of sites here, and we take the square root to have a central limit theorem. So the idea is, again, to look at some kind of central limit theorem. And so the relevant quantity to look at to see whether the spatial correlations are strong. So basically, the strength of those spatial correlations are going to be measured by looking at how much the number of type 1 here is going to fluctuate from the mean. So how can we express that? Well, the number of type 1 in this box is exactly going to be the sum for all x less than n. So we have the norm of x less than n in dimensions 3 or higher. Now I'm looking at the sum over all those sites. To look at the number of type 1, I'm just going to add the xi infinity of x. Xi infinity is the notation I use to say the invariant measure in the coexistence regime. So if I do this, I indeed count the number of type 1 individuals in this big box at equilibrium. Now we want to correct the term by removing the mean. Now we know that for each of these sites is going to be of type 1 with probability rho. Of course, those sites are not independent, but still the probability that each of them individually is of type 1 is rho. So I'm going to remove rho here and take parentheses like that. So that defines a random variable. And then if indeed we have a central limit theorem, like the classical central limit theorem, where those random variables are independently of type 1 with probability 0 and independently of type 0 with probability 1 minus 4, we should have that because the total number of those random variables is equal or of the order, let's say, of 1 over n at the power d. Taking the square root of that, and then I can apply the central limit theorem, we should have convergence when n goes to infinity. So when n goes to infinity, we should have convergence to a Gaussian random variable or normal random variable centered with some variance sigma square. So be careful, this result is not true. That's what the classical central limit theorem would say in case those sites were independent, and that would still be the case if we had like weak spatial correlations. So meaning that if, for instance, you have an exponential decay in the spatial correlation, if you take two sites at distance n of each other, the probability that they are correlated is going to decay exponentially with n. So that would be the result. So now, this aspect of spatial correlation in the coexistence regime at equilibrium was studied in first in this paper by Bronson and Griffiths. The paper was published in 1979, and this one is only about the three-dimensional Wöhler model. But much more recently, Ilyana Zali just extended their result. That was a much more recent paper in 2001 and extended their result to the Wöhler model in any other dimension, so D larger than larger or equal to 4. And the common result in those two papers, if you collapse them, says the following, says that if you are in the coexistence regime where D is strictly larger than 2, then as n goes to infinity, we have indeed this central limit theorem here, but notice that it's not exactly what I wrote on the board. In the slide, you see that the power is not D, but D plus 2. So, going back to the board, this means that assuming that those random variables were independent or at least weakly correlated, so you have weak special correlation, then this will be true, but in fact, we need to add a 2 here. So the exponent d is not correct. If you take exponent d, this sequence, I mean, you, the limit here, this sequence would be degenerated. And to have a non-degenerate limit that is this normal random variable, you need to add 2 to the dimension. So this result shows that even in the coexistence regime, where you have coexistence between the two types, due to those local interactions at equilibrium, those special correlations are still very strong, even if we don't have clustering. Now, the last aspect of the Wöhler model we are going to study is called occupation time, and I'm going back to this picture to illustrate what we mean by that. So, occupation time is exactly the fraction of time a given site is going to be of type 1 as time goes to infinity. And so to kind of illustrate this aspect from the picture, a kind of nice way to look at it by comparing that with the cluster size, for instance, is that when we wanted to study the cluster size, the idea was to fix a large time t and draw this horizontal line, and so look at the size of the cluster. So what we did so far, looking at the cluster size, or also the special correlation at equilibrium, is really look at a specific time and look at what happens across the lattice, across space. Now we are going to do exactly the opposite. Instead, we are going to look at some vertical line like that, and so meaning that now at the opposite, we are going to fix a vertex, doesn't matter which vertex because of translation invariance, and instead we are going to look at what happens across time. So again, what we saw so far was we fix time, we look at what happens across space. Now at the opposite, we fix space, meaning a site, and we look at what happens across time. So first question, how can we, so I'm going to write maybe here what we are studying, maybe I can erase that. What we are studying now is called the occupation time of the Wöhler model. So occupation time. So that's exactly the fraction of time a given site is going to be, let's say, in state 1. So again, like here, I'm going to give you some kind of result that we expect intuitively, and I'm going to show what indeed is true. So occupation time, so fraction of time a given site, let's say x, is of type 1. So to measure this quantity, because the process evolves in continuous time, we need to look at some kind of integral. So if you look at the integral from 0 to t of, let's say, cs of x ds, so this cs of x is going to be alternatively, let's say, equal to 0 or 1, depending on whether x is of type 0 or 1 at time s. If I look at this integral, okay, then I'm looking at the integral of some step function like this, okay, that goes up and down equal to 0 and 1, and then I'm going to indeed measure the length of time, the Lebesgue measure of the length of time at which the process at site X, like the individual at site X, is of type 1. So, indeed, looking at this quantity, I'm indeed looking at the amount of time site X is of type 1 between time 0 and time t. Now, of course, this might go to infinity. So what we want to do is rescale that by t to have the fraction of time we are in state X. So it's 1 over t. And you see that here, even if we don't have a sum, we have instead an integral. We have an integral on some time interval of length t, we divide that by t. So studying the convergence almost surely of this quantity is exactly a type of law of large number. So you see, to study special correlation, that was a central limit theorem that we needed to understand special correlation. Now, occupation time has more something to do with the law of large number. So obviously, studying this quantity is not a consequence of the classical law of large number. I'm just saying that this theorem is of the same type as the law of large number. So, now, what can we guess about this quantity? Well, if we are in dimension 3 or more, we have coexistence. So, we don't have those clusters that keep growing. And so, on the contrary, so even if we saw here that the spatial correlations are very strong, still you have coexistence. So if you look at one given site, it's expected that this site is going to switch back and forth between type 0 and type 1. And so we kind of expect this sequence of random variables to converge almost surely to, in fact, the density of type 1 individual. We know that the density of type 1 individual is preserved by the dynamics. So it's expected that if we take the limit when t goes to infinity here, we should converge almost surely to rho. And this, in the regime where we have coexistence, in the coexistence phase, so that would be if the dimension is strictly larger than t. Okay, so now let's look at what really happens. So again, I'm showing you again those slides. We look at this vertical line, and this integral that I just wrote is going to really correspond to the fraction of time along this vertical line you are of type 0 or of type 1, and so now this aspect of occupation time was studied in this paper by Cox and Griffiths, and their result, surprisingly, says the following. So it says that in dimension larger or equal to 2, the quantity I just wrote on the board is going to converge almost surely to rho. So that's exactly what I wrote, except that d is larger or equal to 2. Okay, so in fact, here, what I wrote is correct, but we have something in fact stronger than that, that's in fact true also in dimension 2. So this result is surprising. Why is it surprising? Well, because we know that in dimension 2 we have clustering. Okay, so we don't really expect to have a law of large number for this quantity. Because we have clustering, it seems that those clusters are going to keep growing, and it seems that that eventually any given site is going to be trapped in a cluster, and then any given site is going to eventually be stuck in state 0 or be stuck in state 1. In which case, we don't have a law of large number for that. This quantity would converge to either 0 or 1, with probability 1 minus rho and rho, and we will not have a law of large number like that. But on the contrary, what we have is that even if there is clustering in two dimensions, we still have this law of large number that holds. Now, in this same paper, it's also proved that this law of large number does not hold in one dimension. But another surprise is that, in fact, in one dimension, we still have this other result that can be easily proved using duality again at the bottom of the slide, which says that we have fluctuation of the Vorder model in any dimensions. So, and fluctuation means that, so we are going to say that the Vorder model fluctuates if no matter the type, I mean, yeah, basically I can express this probability at the bottom by kind of saying that fluctuation means that each individual is going to switch back and forth from type 0 to type 1 infinitely often. This is what fluctuation means. So, going back to the board, we have this law of large number that is true in dimension larger or equal to 2. So, because of that, this kind of shows that 2 is some kind of critical dimension, because that's the only dimension where we have both clustering and this law of large number. And so that means that, again, if you look at what happens across space, you have those clusters growing. But if you look at what happens across time in one given site, this site is going to switch back and forth from 0 to 1 often enough so that we have this law of large number. Now, it turns out that even if the law of large number, again, is not true in one dimension, you still have fluctuation. You are going to switch back and forth from 0 to 1 and 1 to 0. Now, not often enough to have convergence like this, but still you have fluctuation. And so that seems counterintuitive with this idea of clustering. If you have clustering, that means that we saw those clusters keep growing. And so how is it possible that at the same time you have those clusters that keep growing, but if you fix a site, eventually this site is going to switch back and forth from 0 to 1 and 1 to 0? Well, the combination of all these results tells us in fact that for the Vorder model in two dimensions, but even also in one dimension, clusters keep growing forever, so that we have this or even fluctuation, the only explanation is also that those clusters should move. So in fact, the clusters grow forever, they keep growing indefinitely, but they also move around and they move faster than they grow. Okay, so I'm done with my overview of all the results about the Vorder model. So to sum up, what we did is like those 4 points. First, we have this phase transition from clustering to coexistence, going from dimension 2 to dimension 3. Then natural question is, how big are the clusters in 1 and 2 dimensions? The answer is, in one dimension, the cluster size scales like square root of t, square root of the time, but in 2 dimensions, there is no natural scale for the cluster size. Now, moving to coexistence, that's point 3 about spatial correlation under the invariant measure in dimension 3 or more. Even if there is coexistence, we suspect that sites are not independent. And in fact, we have very strong spatial correlation, and that was shown by looking at the natural scaling in the central limit theorem, where we have to add 2 to the dimension to have a non-degenerate limit. So this shows that even in higher dimension, spatial correlations are strong. Fourth question, occupation time. What is now, if we fix a site and look at what happens across time? What is the fraction of time a given site is occupied by, let's say of type 1? And conclusion, we have this law of large number, even in dimension 2. The fact that we also have fluctuation shows that in 1 and 2 dimension, even if those clusters, they keep growing forever, so that we have this, they should also move, and they move quite a lot around.